Welcome to Chemistry with Caroline. In this video, we're going to look at what makes a good nucleophile. So we can look at trends in organic chemistry to figure out the relative rate of nucleophilicity, meaning the rate of attack of a nucleophile on an electrophile. So the first trend we'll look at is charged versus neutral. Now remember, the charge on a nucleophile is always going to be negative or partial negative. And so we have to look at an analogous system. We've got to be comparing apples to apples to use these trends to compare. So hydroxide versus water. In both cases, the nucleophilic atom is an oxygen. And a charged molecule is always going to be more reactive than its neutral counterpart because it's not neutral. But if we look closely at what happens in a reaction where a nucleophile attacks an electrophile, say that we have hydroxide here, the hydroxide is going to come in and attack that electrophile, the carbocation, and that would give us this alcohol, which is a neutral molecule. Whereas if we had water as the nucleophile in the same electrophile, the water can come in and attack. And that would give me this molecule here, which is an alcohol, but it's protonated. And so I have a positively charged product here, whereas the product I form is neutral here. So on the left, you're going from two charged species to one neutral species. On the right, you have a charge on each side. So every charged species is going to be more reactive than its analogous neutral counterpart. So I wouldn't have to have an oxygen to do this comparison, but to make an apples to apples comparison, I would have to be looking at the same type of nucleophilic atom. Another trend we can look at to analyze nucleophilicity is electronegativity. And we would use this trend whenever we're going across the periodic table. So I've picked some second row elements here. I have NR2 minus, OR minus, and F minus. And I'm looking at their relative nucleophilicity based on their electronegativity. Remember, electronegativity is an affinity for electrons, and F is the most electronegative element on the periodic table. So this has the highest affinity for electrons. So what that means is that fluoride is going to be most stable with a negative charge. If it's more stable, it's going to be less reactive. And so the NR2, with N being the least electronegative atom, is going to be the most nucleophilic and the most reactive, then OR minus, then F minus. So this is the most nucleophilic atom because it is the least electronegative atom. It has the lowest affinity for electrons, and therefore it's more likely to act as a nucleophile. The third trend we'll look at is size, and we're going to look at size when we go down the periodic table. So within a column on the periodic table, size would be the predominant trend that you would be looking at. Because every time we go down one row, we have a whole new shell of electrons, and so size changes in a significant way down the periodic table. So here I have the halogens. I have chloride, bromide, and iodide. All can react as a nucleophile. What happens with size is as the atomic radius gets bigger, the atom gets more polarizable, which basically just means it can sort of have electrons come to one side versus the other, and it can almost squish and start to bond from further away. So I'm going to write us a note. Larger atomic radius equals more polarizable. So if we think about a transition state structure, right, you've got an iodine or some nucleophile making a bond to some electrophile, and this bond right here is being formed. So we draw a dashed line. Because iodine is bigger, it can sort of squish and shift the electrons to one side, polarizing the atom, so that that bonding occurs from further away, which is stabilizing to that transition state and lowers the energy for that reaction. So if we think about an iodine or an iodide, it's just a sphere, right? So the atomic radius, it looks like one big sphere. As the iodide gets close to the electrophile, the electrons can will start to shift because they feel the attractive force of that partial positive. And so the iodide can kind of squish out more, so you get more of a partial negative here when in the presence of this partial positive. The larger the atom, the more polarizable it is, and the further away bonding can happen, which will just stabilize that transition state. The last trend we'll look at is steric hindrance. And so here I have a series of nucleophiles, all have the same nucleophilic atom, oxygen, and specifically an oxygen with a negative charge, but the neighboring group has different degrees of steric hindrance. So here I have a primary carbon next door, here I have a secondary carbon next door, and there I have a tertiary carbon next door. And so the bulk of the group that's attached to the nucleophilic atom is going to influence its nucleophilicity, because a nucleophile would have to come in to attack an electrophile. And the more bulky the group that is attached is, the more steric hindrance that transition state structure is going to experience. So the less hindered is going to be the more nucleophilic. So if we did a competition experiment where we had all three of these nucleophiles present and one electrophile, we'd see that the nucleophilicity, or the rate of attack for the least hindered one, would be the fastest. And that would be the predominant product that we would see. So this has been a look at trends that influence nucleophilicity. If you found this video helpful, please like, subscribe, and share with your friends.